So welcome everyone. It's a pleasure to see the amphitheater full today, and we have the pleasure to welcome Gérard Berry for seminaire d'ouverture. So Gérard started his career in 1967, where he traveled through the Atacama Desert. So he was already inspired by the Atacama Desert. Maybe he wanted to be an astronomer, he told me at that time. But he moved quickly to computer sciences. He had done a brilliant career. He founded an industry in Sofia Antipolis. He had a gold medal of CNRS, and now he has the second chair to Collège de France, and he's very interested in the relationship between computer science and the way we think science through computers. So Gérard, it's a pleasure to have you, and thank you.
Thank you for having invited me. So we'll try to show you what's going on with informatics and sciences. My argument is that there is a very, very deep revolution which is perpendicular to that of mathematics, and that the two of them together will make it possible to do things that were absolutely plain impossible short ago. Actually, what I will say is largely contained in a book which just got out called Hyperpower of Informatics, L'hyperpuissance de l'informatique. And there is a part on astronomy, short. There are two parts. One, I discussed with François Combe on what to put, and a second part about bugs in computer bugs. I will talk about that. And in astronomy, you have seen, for example, Schiaparelli recently. It so happened that I've read the report, and this is, I would say, amateur bugs. And it's too bad to put amateurs at that level of cost. Anyway, what's going on? What's going on? First, I won't talk about social networks and what you hear in the newspapers, okay? No word about that. You hear only informatics is only social networks in newspapers. I won't talk about that. It's something very deep is happening, and which is very often underestimated, because somehow many people in sciences still view informatics as a way to do some computation where we cannot do by hand. But I assure you it's not that at all. It's much more. It's a real change in mind, in mindset. And so why is there a change in mindset? Because the 20th century was about a triangle, a golden triangle, between matter, energy, and waves. So astronomy deals with the three of those, absolutely clear. So that's very reasonable. It took time to understand this triangle. This is not yet done. But this triangle had shaped the mind of people. And in the 21st century, something very different came in, which is information. And information in the 20th century did not quite exist. In physics, some people talked about information related to entropy and so on, but it was a second-class concept. And for the other people, information was only exchanged with humans, between humans. And it's not true anymore. Information is at the heart of a lot of things. And the problem, which I see everywhere, is that people try to apply to information what they learn about matter, energy, and waves. They try to put their old reasoning way, their normal reasoning way, and to do it with information. But information is completely different from the three other guys. For example, you cannot duplicate matter easily. You can duplicate information easily. You cannot transport matter and energy easily. Transporting information is trivial. Information depends on matter and energy, but not quite, because when you store an information on a disk, on a flash, on whatever, it doesn't matter. Information is sensitive to matter and to energy. It needs a little bit of it, but whichever doesn't matter. So that's completely different from, and all the reasonings will be different. And also, information is extremely powerful. And that's something which is very underestimated, and we'll show you why it is important. So What I want to do in this talk is to illustrate this with information and algorithms. One can do things that are impossible with physics. Well, you would say you need physics for information. Yes, but it's not the same physics. Okay. What are the four pillars of informatics? The four pillars are information. I will not try to define what is information. This is a very hard concept. Because, for example, when you say it's 20 degrees in this room, is it an information? No, it's a data. And information depends on the interpretation context. So it's 20 degrees, you have to know what is a degree. Otherwise, 20 is a data, degree is another data, but you have to know it. Then you have to ask yourself whether it is Fahrenheit or Celsius or whatever, Réaumur. Let's stick to data for the time being. I think you know the difference between the two. That will not be a problem. So algorithms, a completely unknown world. For example, recently I talk at the Academy of Medicine in many places like that. And the only question I get at the end is, what is an algorithm? Which proves that the ignorance level is extremely high. And at radio, I go often to La Tête au Carré or to very nice radio. We have very good radio broadcasts, and the question is always, can you explain me what is an algorithm? So I guess you know that. It's a way to order in time and in parallel or in sequence operations, to do trivial operations, to do something non-trivial. And there are thousands and thousands of algorithms, more every day, and it's a big science. And languages, because you need to write the algorithms, and this is a completely different. Inventing and writing is completely different. And people think there is a unified mathematical language, which is not quite true, but it's still quite true also. And that's not true in informatics. The language problem is really a difficult one, especially, for example, I discussed with students this morning. And I tell that in some sense, Python, which is the universal language now in science, is a complete regression in scientific terms, because people have been working a lot on how to avoid bugs by better challenges, and Python has thrown away absolutely all the knowledge in this field. Anyway, but it has other obvious use. And machines. And so machines made a lot of progress because of physics, and Moore's law will stop, not because of physics, but because of economy and the fact that we don't quite know how to use that many transistors, and not only because of physics. Okay, so, and of course, you can, the machines are so immensely complicated now that there is no way to see what's inside the machine. They are all built by algorithms. And you will see that this will expand. And information is not between us. It's between most of the information in the world becomes from objects, not from human beings. Human beings cannot write fast, but objects can write fast. And you know that in astronomy because you have a huge flow of information. And you need a blue gene to handle one interferometer, so you know about that. Good. What I liked compared to astronomy or biology in computing is that it's a synthetic science. It's not a natural science. In natural sciences, you need 10 years to make an experiment and to get the result, like Ligo Virgo. And in informatics, it's not that. We build everything. So you know the first search engine. And maybe some people in the room remember that there was a world before Google. It's very hard to know how we did things, very hard to remember that. But the first search engine, it took two months and a half to build it. The hard part is to get the right ID, which is true also in other sciences. And there is another component, which is bugs. I will talk about that a little. If you ignore bugs, please don't touch informatics. Informatics with or without bugs is not the same game. People don't know this guy, Al-Khwarizmi, who invented a lot of things. So the Arabian digits come from him. He was actually a Persian, but he was written in Arabian. And they were imported for. And he also made a treaty with a very long name, but with algebra in it, which gave the word algebra. So it's very strange that nobody at school tells people that algebra comes from a man and not from God. So informatics is global. So that's a notion that people tend not to understand. There is a single notion of information and a single notion of algorithm. It's the same everywhere. Whatever you talk about, media, photography, sound, telecom, astronomy, biology, neurology, it's exactly the same notion of information and exactly the same set of algorithms. So that's not trivial, because in physics, it's not true. Liquids and solid is quite different. The physical laws are still very common. A single notion of algorithm. And the information level is very efficient. And I realized that when I was a kid. It was the Cold War, which is similar to what we have now. And I was, and people were fighting about the weight of bombs. I mean, the power of bombs, 1 kiloton and then 100 megatons. And I was struck by the fact that you need exactly the same message to blow a bomb of 1 kilo or 100 megatons, okay? Exactly the same message. So the information is insensitive to matter. It's another business. And lots of people don't understand that yet, and they make complete mistake about what they think of informatics because of that. I think scientists know that a little bit. And reasoning and acting with information is completely different from reasoning and acting with matter and energy. A good example is ABS in cars. Okay, you have the brakes, you press on the pedal and the brakes before, mechanically, they will all brake together. And it's a very bad idea because the wheels are not at the same places. So you invent ABS. What is ABS? It's an algorithm that will decide independently for each wheel what to do. You could do that, then how would you drive your car with 4 brake pedals? Huh? You can't, because your brain may not have the sensors and may have not have the actuator. So with information, it's quite easy to do. Good. And so my motto with this, understanding the nature of informatics and not the technique of informatics. If you don't understand the nature, you cannot understand the technique. And that's true for math. Huh? Good. So what is informatics doing? First, it's transforming schemes like e-commerce and so on, and online science. I remember when I was in the 70s, when in a conference, you would have paper submissions and paper photocopies sent to all the program committee members that would take a plane with their 20 kilograms of paper to discuss the papers. And it's very strange to think of that now. But totally new schemes. Search engines, it's a completely new scheme, unthinkable with matter. Huh? Wikipedia, of course, dematerialized stuff, transportation, you know, data analysis, I will talk a little bit on that. This is the only subject which is discussed now together with social networks, but what people say is mostly bullshit, although there are many things that are true. Collaborative science, astronomy is a very, very good example of a collaborative science, and so on. And what is changing the game is the Internet of Things. There are many, it's very simple calculation, 80 billion microprocessors produced per year, 1.5 million telephones, 500,000 computers. Where is the rest? In objects. Most of the computers are in objects and equipment. So I'd like to explain, before going to science, what I call mental inversions. That is, this movement is so powerful that it may the thinking of kids backwards, completely different from the thinking of their parents. And it's very interesting to see. For the telephones, for example, we have a wireless telephone. What does it mean? It means a lot. For kids, I like this story of Eric Spitz, who was the director of Thomson NCR. His grandson came and saw a telephone with a wire going to a wall, and he asked this wonderful question. He had this wonderful question after that. It's, why did you put an anti-theft cable? Which is a very interesting question. This is interesting. When I called a friend when I was 20, okay, the only answer I had was she was not home. And now when I call her, I say, where are you? So it's a total inversion. It's not a detail, it's a complete change. This is what the 4 years old guy say. And this is the son of a friend in Sofia Antipolis, a computer scientist, who came back from his neighbor and said, "Dad, our neighbor has a fabulous computer. You hit the keyboard and say, there it prints." What did he see? A typewriter. Huh? And this one is very nice too, 10 years old. "Mama, you told me you had no computer at my age. Then how did you connect to the internet?" And you see, so it's not a detail. It's not an increment. It's a total change. Okay, so now let's go to sciences. You know these famous sentences, okay? Galileo and Einstein. I put this because the long version is a little bit different, but it doesn't matter. So it's not true. It's true for physics and astronomy, but that's all. It's not true in other sciences. In biology, there was no math in biology, basically, almost no math, especially statistics were born by biology, but anyway. So it's not true. And what I conjecture, and what I want to show you, is that it will become true if you couple informatics and mathematics. Any of the two is not sufficient, but if you couple the two, the game becomes entirely different. Good. So let's start with instruments. Photography. So I have a long chapter in my book about what is a digital camera. So a camera, the first digital cameras were physics sensors plus minimal algorithm to extract the image. The modern cameras are algorithms plus minimal sensors to get the light. It's totally reversed to an incredible point, and I will just show you a little bit of example. So this is a wide angle, so you know what a wide angle does. It does curves from line and so on. So in the 20th century, you were mostly done, or you can, it was very hard to make the real image. And now inside the camera, what happens is that you don't see the original image, but you see this one, which has no more curves, and the light has been completely changed as well. So it's not at all the reality, it's what you want to see, except that the projectors are very variable. So here, just to write. And what's happened? Since physical destructions are predictable, algorithms can unwind them. And it's very hard for physics to unwind distortions. But for example, when you buy an Nikon, a Canon camera, you have big lenses with lots of lenses inside, and very expensive and heavy to minimize distortion. Very bad idea. If you use algorithm to unwind the distortion, you should make the lenses much simpler, because the lenses you can buy now are very complicated to undistort. So a telephone, for example, has an incredibly small lens, and it has very high quality picture. How come? You can check one thing on your telephone. You press on the shutter, and you will discover that the picture is taken before you press, not after. Think of that and try to understand why it is a very good idea to take the picture before you press the shutter instead of after. Uh-huh. And of course, with another click, you can get that if you want. Quite easy, mathematically speaking. Any astronomer does that every day, so I won't explain you. Okay? But you can do much more. Typically, in astronomy, you do gravitational lenses, you know about that, and it's exactly the same story, except it's a little more involved, because the astronomers are more interested in the image than the people who take pictures with their telephone and throw them away. And it's very interesting, because here, physically interpreting this image is very hard, but you need mathematics and computing to be able to understand what's going on in these images and what they show. Good. So, for example, and you know that in astronomy too, you have a problem with the sensors that don't have enough dynamics. And so there is one solution, which is HDR, which is to take four pictures, for example, of Place Sainte-Chapelle, with four different openings, and to use algorithm to mix them to get that. So this is now done on all telephones. Huh? All telephones do that. You don't know it, but all telephones do that internally. And in telephone, it's hard to do because it's done with a battery. That's a big problem, because the algorithms are not trivial. Actually, you can do much better with deep learning. This has been done. I can explain you during the question session if you want. Fabulous things are done there. This is also something which is now becomes routine in cameras, is that you have a very short depth of field if you do macro photo. But what you can do is to take several photos. Here, in fact, it's a set of a series of eight. And then you, this is the one on the head, the one on the tail, and this is the combined photo. And you have not to be naive. And these algorithms are difficult. And the anti-noise, for example, the anti-noising of DxO, a French company, won the great prize of INRIA Academy des Sciences, Jean-Michel Morel in Orsay, for his absolutely fabulous anti-noising algorithm. Very hard stuff. And for example, I have this little camera, which I hooked to my iPhone. This camera has extremely high image quality, much better than an iPhone, which is already very good. And the lens touches the sensor, and if you look at the lens, it's completely different. So the lens is computed in function of the algorithms, basically. And by algorithms. Okay, so you know the digital 3D maps because, of course, satellites have been. But what is this? It's a fusion of a set of data, very varied data actually, data on the ground, data in space, and so on. And this is a thing which is dealing with pure information. If you try to do that with matter, you just have no chance of success. Okay. It's dealing with pure information, and you can go very, very far in what you do. It's done on Mars, of course. It's done on. You try to do it on the exoplanets. Good. Maybe the biggest revolution is in medical imaging. Medical imaging is incredibly sophisticated. So, very few people and no doctor know that an IRM machine, MRI machine, is physics. Of course, non-trivial physics, relaxation of proton changes in, and a lot of algorithms. And right now, the price of an MRI machine is about split between the price of algorithm and the price of physics. And the progress are done in mostly in algorithm because physics is just too hard, or it's just too good. So this is routine image. I had research images in my book, and I replayed them by routine image in a clinic in the north of Paris. We do, on the 2nd of May, a colloquium on medical imaging and learning and artificial intelligence. And this is a routine image for a doctor. It's not science fiction. This is how doctors operate you by mini-invasive surgery. You are in a scanner. Or maybe the image has been taken before, and the doctor is here. He looked at the screen, not at you. And he had made a little hole here, and he's operating your heart or your brain this way. And the patient has become virtual somehow. And this is very good, because then they remove the thing, and you go back home. And a big change compared to opening your chest, for example, for the heart. So it operates with information on the screen. Here is a screen, for example, a typical screen. So here you have an image which is a fusion of a PET scan and a positron scan and a CT scan, X-ray scan. So it's a 3D image. Here it's the image reconstructed by the internal instrument, which has things to measure distances around it. And so this image is reconstructed from the instrument. This is a virtual reality added. Here is what has to be treated, and here is what is treated by radio frequency. And actually, the instruments themselves are projected virtual reality inside. This is everyday work. This is not science fiction anymore. This is everyday in a normal clinic in Paris. Well, high-end clinic in Paris. And you see, this photo is taken with a telephone during an operation. It's not research. That's quite interesting. So fusion between different information is a big game in astronomy. But it's very elaborate now in medicine. For example, you have a lot of different MRIs or scan. Anatomy, so that's a scan. Ici, angio, so this is with radioactive products. Diffusion, that give, show you the nerve, the axons, basically, in the brain, spectro-functional, I show you the energy consumption. And before, the doctors had to look at each image separately, which is the same for astronomers. And now it becomes routine to make a 3D thing or a 4D things. And here is a tumor in the brain, and to measure automatically the volume. How do you do that by hand? Measuring the volume of a tumor that has a strange shape is completely impossible. You could do it with physics, for example, remove the tumor, put it in water, and look at how much water, but it's not quite practical. And of course, this is making a big revolution in medicine. And I think if you compare to what you do in astronomy, the principles are the same. You have different views of different measure on the same part of the sky, and you want to have a single view for you, not to spend your time looking at 25 images. And so you put fake colors, just say, this is, of course, fake colors in exactly the same way. So medicine, astronomy, the same science. Ah, this was not true quite. Oh, yeah, that was astrology, sorry. You can go very far. For example, here, the surgeon operates a liver. Liver operations are very delicate. And the liver is hard to see, and it's full of blood, and so on. And so what is done is that the liver is projected in 3D inside the body. And what the surgeon sees is a superposition of the 3D image in the body. And there are now incredible instruments that you put the 3D glasses and you see the inside of people. It's really impressive. And real time. Huh? Okay, so of course, in astronomy, you know about that, although the people still, I think that very often the computing people are sort of second class people. And you see that quite easily. For example, Hubble has a little physics bug that was pre-corrected by algorithms, but not completely. I know very well he was in my lab, the head of the Planck project in Cannes. And if you look at robots like Spirit, I will show you that Spirit almost, Pathfinder and Spirit almost died when they landed because of stupid software bugs. The Spirit story is fabulous. I tell it in detail in my book. And Philae, for example, I got invited at La Tête au Carré by Mathieu Vidard the day of my gold medal. And it was the day where Philae landed in Chory. And everybody was, of course, stunned. But I made a little remark. I say, I've never, never heard anybody tell that this is also a prodigy of mathematics and informatics. Never. Never, never, ever I read or heard this. While it is true, it's a prodigy of many things, including informatics. Because, you know, landing on a Chory is not just by guiding with a joystick. Yeah? Good. Computer simulation. So that's a big game in astronomy. Last year I made a colloquium, and two years ago I made a colloquium with a talk by Romain Tessier on simulation of galaxies, and I discussed that with Françoise Combelot. So what is computer simulation? Well, it's reproducing natural phenomena in computers to better understand them, which we'll see that we have a deeper interpretation later. So somehow it has to do, Feynman did not know this kind of simulation, but Feynman's sentence has to do with what you want to do with simulation. And so it's a mixture of applied math, supercomputers, programming, and so on. And it's quite interesting because you do simulation also in two cases. When the experiments are too expensive, for example, in condensed matter experiments, they do a lot of simulation because, I don't know if you know the figure, the price of a computer, put the price of a mathematician at one. So one pencil per year, okay? Then the computer scientist is one PC every 5 years, so you put it at 1.2, okay? Physicist is 25, an astronomer, I think, 25, and a biologist is 20. So because you have a difficult thing. So it's interesting because this is Ariane. This is Ariane reactor, And you want to know what's happening there, what are the turbulences, what is the temperature. It's quite hard to follow Ariane with a thermometer in flight, okay? So you have no choice. You have no choice but simulation. Eh? And this is it's a film, movie, actually. It's quite interesting. And of course, for example, the astronomers did never get the budget to blowing a supernova in the lab. Right? And I'm quite happy of that, by the way. And simulation is a way to analyze what is... So here it's deeply related to the mathematics because you simulate equations. You know the equations, or you know more or less the equations, and you try to solve the equation, but that's a little hard. You try to solve them numerically, which is not easy. For example, the solar system simulations are not yet over, and maybe never. So that's interesting. So that's the role of simulation. But I will show you that you can do simulation in very different ways, that you can do simulation with no equations. And that dates back to von Neumann, who was not a stupid guy. So here the game is to simulate dunes. It's a work done at Institut de Physique du Globe de Paris by Clément Artaud and his team. So dunes are very interesting structures, are beautiful, and they are also on Mars, and they have lots of shapes. It's only four shapes, star dunes, linear dunes, Barkhan, this kind of oscillation. So you use another thing that is called cellular automata. You can actually do relativity with cellular automata. This is done in Marseille and in the team of Gabriele Veneziano, Pablo Arrighi, and so on. So it's just you cut the space into little cubes, which are not cubes of matter. They are theoretical cubes, okay? And you will have only local rules, completely local, no global view of the system, no continuous view either, just discrete local rules. And you have simple laws like that. So this is fluid, this is immobile, and this is mobile sand. And the rules are deposition, something mobile can stay with an air, can stop, and so on. And you have erosion, that is something that was, when the fluid comes to something, it can make it mobile. Very simple rules, totally local. Gravity, of course, it can fall, but not. It needs winds to go up. And these rules have probabilities on the arrow, and the probabilities are calculated differently. They are calculated by another cellular automaton, gas sur réseau, comment on dit ça? Gas on network? I don't know. I mean, cellular automata for fluid mechanics, which are quite well known. And that's fine. So you have to, the probabilities depend on the nature of the material, of course. And then you need also avalanches. Avalanches are a little less local, but still local. That is, the slope cannot be bigger than some value. And in that case, this guy has to fall there, but this makes another slope, and it's a little recursive. But nothing special, nothing more. And then, here is what you get. This is real dunes, this is simulated dunes. It looks the same, really, and with details. That is the secondary dunes here, which are not well predicted by continuous models, are also continuous models. They are there. And for example, if you put a constant wind on a pack of sand, you get this, which is really the right form with the secondary dunes here. And you need to iterate a few million times just by random. You pick randomly cells, and you just pick a rule with a probability, and you apply it. That's all. That's all what you do. And do the same for the gas. And you can observe very nice phenomena, which are very inaccessible to classical method. That is, if you put two sand, colored sand, or by physical method, you can do it, but it's not trivial. And you get, you see, in that case, if it's in line, you get a kind of mixture of the two up to the secondary dune. If you put it slightly on the side, you get something completely different. A secondary dune with a mixture and a first dune with a complete separation. So this is something which is not classical mathematics. In some sense, it is mathematics, but without a computer, you cannot do the mathematics. And the star dunes are quite interesting because they come when there are different orientation of the wind. And nobody ever understood how they grew before. And it's a reasonable answer they get. And this is a true star dune, and this is a simulated star dune. So just to show you that this kind of thing is not limited to equations. You can simulate without equations, and of course you can simulate with equations or with mixture. Good. Simulation is quite used in medicine now. This is tetralogy de Fallot, bad disease for kids, and surgery has a common point with computing, is that it's cut and paste. Okay, so the surgeon has to cut somewhere and to paste, but where to cut? So now there are big projects that are really having success on simulating the heart. And everything, almost the heart is complicated because it's a fluid mechanics, solid mechanics, contractible solid mechanics, electricity propagation, and valves. Valves are the hardest part. And so you can predict reasonably well where to cut. That is, you can do optimization of where to cut from the, you have a general model of the body that will you particularize for a particular patient. You do that for the brain too. And and surgeons now are really fans of computer science, which is not true of your local doctor, which doesn't even know how to connect to internet. But what is simulation about? Simulation, come back to the triangle of the beginning and tetrahedron. Simulation simply replaces matter and energy by information, and waves, by information. The relation between wave and information is very clear somehow, but Shannon, but not for matter. So this is the golden rule. Replace matter and energy by information. Replace laws of nature by algorithmic equivalent program, which is not necessary a three-character long law. And in physics, the golden rule was a good law of nature must be like general relativity, small line, if you understand the 200 pages before. It's a little cheating as well. But no, it can be a long program text as well. And for example, we can simulate trees now. And simulating a tree is interesting because the botanists have cataloged trees, but I've never explained what is a tree. When you simulate something, you have to explain what it is. Up to some point. Ah, so simulation is very important to understand things, not only to imitate things. And so algorithmic laws of nature are really interesting. And for example, it's not clear to me that it will be a natural idea to use continuum mechanics for the first instance of the universe. It may happen that things like cellular automata and so on are simpler because they don't have the same drawbacks. They have their drawbacks, but not the same. So the mathematics of the continuous has one problem, big problem. This is why people do cellular automata as well for relativity and so on. There is a fundamental principle in physics that any finite volume should have finite information inside. And real numbers are infinite information. So whenever you talk of real numbers, you violate this very simple principle of finite information. So there is still a lot of fundamental things to study. So what you do as well is to replace physical time by computer time. Ah, you can go fast for slow phenomena for galaxies. If you try to simulate the galaxy at the speed of galaxies, it's not very useful. Slow simulation of fast phenomena. I will show you the simulation of the folding of proteins. Real-time simulation when you do a fast simulator. You can play with the time when you simulate. That's absolutely fundamental as well. And simulation requires matter and energy, but which have no relationship whatsoever, is the same computer for all simulation. This is universal machine. There is no universal matter. There is no universal energy. We have universal computers. No difference between a Mac, a PC, or a blue jean. Bioinformatics. I will be short on that one. Look at remember this picture? It's the same for life sciences. Look, the interface, the input is the sun and sandwiches, okay? Information is in DNA and epigenetics, and maybe, and also internal memory. Languages are, for example, genes. There are probably many other languages we ignore. There is also the neural code in the brain. Machines are the cell, for example. And the output is a replication, which is cool. We don't know how to replicate telescope in a sexual way, or asexual. And a large molecule like ATP, which allows us to move. So exactly the same thing for the living things. So some domain, DNA analysis, this is big data analysis. It's interesting because the biologists are producing so much data, the increase in sequencing is 10, the increase, Moore's law is doubling every 2 years. Sequencing is multiplied by 10 every year, which means that we are already in the case that we cannot produce enough disks to put the data in biology. So you astronomers are small players compared to biologists. It's amazing. The cell is an information system. It's a real information, including an operating system. For example, in a cell, there are mechanisms to kill and garbage all proteins. When a protein gets old, it starts malfunctioning, and there are a lot of mechanisms in the cell, like the garbage collector in your computer, to kill the old protein, or to sort out proteins so that in the egg cell, you put only young proteins and not old proteins. This is of course, based on information. The immune system clearly has to be studied this way. Simulation of organs, population dynamics, these are new fields in biology. But biologists know absolutely zero in general of informatics, the old biologists. And Institut Pasteur now forces all PhD students and postdocs to spend 2 months in intensive courses because they all spend their time on computers. So who in this room got more than 5 hours teaching of informatics? Of real informatics. Okay, so it's good. It's good for a scientific place. So the game in biology, we can put it in an interesting way, which is, of course, provocative. How far can we get, we forget about the details of molecules in the living? For example, if you want, that's a problem we had with electronics physics people. If you want to understand a computer, there is one thing you should never look at, the transistor. The transistor has nothing to do with computation. So if you understand what is a transistor, it may prevent you to understand what is informatics. Because we use the transistor in a completely degraded 0-1 mode. Maybe now with new machines, more analog for learning, it will be different. But If you want to understand, please don't study transistors. Otherwise, you will be completely unable to understand Boolean logic. Biochemistry, so you make nice movies in astronomy, but they are not bad either. That's an old movie in low resolution of the DNA reproduction. So, people are taught in the school about DNA reproduction, and nobody understands anything because it's a dynamic phenomenon. And this movie, although it is very simple, you see the input DNA and you see the fibers and so on. I won't insist on that. But molecules are sort of complex objects. So this is the DNA polymerase, the one that was at work there. And these molecules are studied heavily with computing now. It's a long-range project, so same length as astronomic project. It will take forever to study that. There are many proteins. And what is very important is the folding of proteins. And here is something that biologists have trouble dealing with. Ah, yes. Okay. They have trouble dealing with because they are not quite used to degrees of abstraction. Well, in astronomy, you know what is the degree of abstraction, okay? You talk about stellar systems, about galaxies, and so on. So this is a simulation of a folding of a protein. So you see the intermediate state. So it's not that different from what you do in astronomy. And then it takes a long time to get to the stable state where the protein becomes functional, you see. So it's 6 microseconds here you simulate, and it will reach the right form. It's a vibration, so it's laws of physics. It's not that different from stars. For an informatics person, it's the same. It's the same kind of techniques. It is physics. But that's different. That's quite different. Do you find that in astronomy too? simulation are simulation with several degrees of abstraction. Here you are not interested in all phenomena. And so you put fake colors and you put things and you ignore parts, you see, you abstract away parts. And that's something biologists are absolutely not used to. But of course you do that in galaxies, because when you have a galaxy simulation, you have the birth of stars, which is not the same laws as the gravity and so on, and you need to mix these different degrees of abstraction. But I think biology will be harder, because there are many more phenomena in play. And there is a very nice project called, you remember SETI at home, but now you have folding at home. I never believed SETI at home as really any use, but folding at home is serious. So you can put your computer to as a protein folder, because this is very heavy calculation. You can also program with DNA, which is fun. You can build computers with computers. It's an abstract machine. So you can build computers with DNA. And for example, a signal is a DNA thread. It's not thread, but anyway. And a logic gate is a double strand, single DNA strand. And gate is a double strand. So for example, you can do A plus B done C here. Sorry. And you can do that, because you can synthesize the DNA you want. You just put your credit card, the ATCG letter, and your credit card. And there you go. And 2 days after that, you receive the samples, you mix them, and you let the machine go, and it works. It works here. Yeah, it doesn't quite work. Should work, but anyway. So now they are programming language. Ah, yes. It was working. Now there are programming languages for programming with DNA, and DNA is also very intensive research as support for, you see, that's the way it works, the machine. This will unwind the thing, the other one comes here, and then it will release the blue part, which is the C, and to see the C, you will attach it to another strand of DNA with phosphorescence here, and it will glow. So if your solution glows, it means your reaction has worked. And you can do quite interesting. The idea is to repair inside the cell in the long range. This is the language for DNA. And this is the simulation of an apple tree, for example. So you don't simulate everything. You don't simulate the growth of the trunk, because it has no importance whatsoever in trees, just a secondary phenomena. But you simulate the complete evolution with fruits and leaves. That's an old one that I do much better now. So it's understanding what is a tree. And the program is 2 pages long. And it has very few coefficients. They have simulated a family of 20 apple trees, and there are very few variations between them, a few parameter change period. So that's a new way to look at nature, very different from classical math. Neurosciences, you get the same picture. Huh? Here, the input is the senses. The data is in, we don't know. The spike code is really not understood. The language, we don't know. Machine is the brain. And the result is that you can play guitar or walk or do all sorts of interesting things like astronomy. Good, so that's quite interesting what's going on. I will end up with one problem, major, including for you. So this is the car I bought when I got in 1970, when I went out of school. So it's a car of the 20th century. But the one in the 21st century are exactly identical. 4 wheels, 4 seats, a glass. The shape has changed. What has changed is essentially the inside. So a car is a few hundred computers with wheels and an engine. That's what is a car now. It's a set of computers with wheels and an engine. Okay. There are 100 million of lines of code in a car. Not mastered at all, but that's another problem. And soon they will talk to other cars and try to drive autonomously and so on. It's not yet done. But right now, the cars have lots of bugs. If you read the book, there are pages on the bugs of the car that killed quite a lot of people, actually. It's serious. And so the problem is, what is a bug? And I think it's fundamental to anybody that wants to understand the essence of a bug. And I took a long time to be able to explain that, but I think here is an answer. So the problem here is that there is a big, big gap between two different beasts. Here you have Kepler. So Kepler is very intuitive. That's a bug in the transport of the slide. This should be in fuzzy characters. But that was on the Mac. My Mac got stolen, so now I have a PC, and in the PC, the fuzzy characters. So it's the contrary of this. It's not rigorous. It tries to be rigorous. Even Kepler does its best, but it's not quite rigorous, a computer. So, and slow. So this is a man. Intuitive, not quite rigorous, and very slow. This is a Pentium. Hyper-fast, hyper-exact, hyper-stupid. Okay? So it's a huge gap. It's the biggest gap ever built, I think. And so the problem of informatics is to transport an idea of the brain here to a stupid program in the computer here. And this is, by essence, difficult because the distance is very big. And if you don't master it, then you kill your system with bugs. Let's see an example. So as example, I use Manhattan here, okay, without Broadway. I live here, I had a friend living here, and I tell her, can you come home? Hey, how do I do? It's complicated because there are one-way streets, work in progress, and so on, so you can never go straight in Manhattan. So I say the simplest way is to believe you are a computer, so I will give you stupid instructions, and you follow them, period. So here is the first instruction, okay? T is straight, tout droit. D is right, droite. And G is gauche, left. And at each crossroads here, you do what is written. So it will do that. Now assume there is one human mistake. A bug is never, people think that bugs are machine failures, program failures. No, program never fail. Human failed. A bug is a human failure in the writing or printing or whatever of the program. So assume you make a failure in dictation. And for example, the guy made a miss, did not note on the phone as it should be. So human failure, you just change his T into D. Okay, what's going on? Almost nothing. One cross, you see, this is exactly the same shape, it just turned 90 degrees. So the gross result is that with the the machine obeys the program. Okay, so it goes nowhere. If you make the error in another place, it goes to another nowhere. And the problem is that the number of nowhere is very high compared to the number of good where. Okay? And that's it. So this is the best definition of a computer I know. A computer is the most extraordinary error amplifier ever built. If you don't know that, don't try to write programs. If you know that your program has a bug. Okay? And then you will start understanding how to work, maybe. Good. So a good example are Spirit. I can tell you the Spirit bug. It's fantastic. And Spirit and Pathfinder were saved really, really at the last minute. And it's very nice because they worked like crazy after that. And so conclusion, it started as a tool to perform mathematical computation. Now it's much more way. It's a different way to think, way of thinking, okay, and act. Based on algorithm and computers, it's completely compatible with the rest. The problem is the ubiquity, simplicity, and efficiency of the information lever. The information lever can lift anything of the different weights, which the physical levers cannot do. It works together with all activities. There is no... The informatics you need in astronomy is not different from the one you need in medicine. It's the same. And this is not true for matter and energy. It's not at all true. Except for medicine, the waves are similar. But the bug security problems are not taken seriously. And voilà, and we made a real breakthrough in France. We decided to stop teaching informatics in 1997 when internet exploded. It was taught before, but we decided to stop the teaching, which means that a normal student of France goes to baccalaureate with exactly 0 seconds of knowledge about this subject, which is shaping the 21st century. So this is changing, but slowly. Thank you.
Thank you, Gérard. I think there must be plenty of questions. Henry, of course.
Great talk. I'm an astronomer, so I'll use that to apologize. For the three questions I want to ask, I mean, essentially, we have this process now where we're in the process of virtualizing the entire universe in computers and representing the observable universe in computer bits. And, well, there are three problems I'm sure you've heard many times, and I'd just like to hear what your comments are. The first problem is that in science, of course, is the problem of reproducibility. For instance, when you do a scientific experiment and someone else uses a computer or a simulation, it may not be reproducible. I wrote them down because I don't want to forget. And the second question is reliability, obviously, because when you observe something, it's no longer defined by data, but it's defined by algorithms. And then the third question, which is particularly problematic for astronomers, is the issue related to archivability. In other words, are we able to recover what we observed in the past, in the future, when storage media and so on have changed? Thanks.
Okay, so the first question about representation is, of course, a very hard one, because the problem, for example, there is a mention in biology, okay, there are too much data to be represented, to be stored. There is a lot of work in a branch of that is just common between maths and informatics, called compressed sensing, which is that the information contained in a message is not related to the number of bits. It's related to what you want to see. And compressed sensing is sort of reducing the information enormously. The good example is the retina. When I was a kid, I was explained that the retina transmits the image to the brain. This is plain wrong. The retina transmits almost nothing to the brain. Okay? And the retina you see only in a cone like that. And the image you have is a complete algorithmic reconstruction. It doesn't exist anywhere. So there is a very high compressed sensing of many thousands by the retina. Because the brain knows what it wants to see. Okay, so the question of that is, there is an idea that will never fly, which is to say, I gather lots of data, and I will see afterwards what I do with it. This idea cannot work. The problem is that compressed sensing, that is reducing the data you want to have, needs criteria. And so the biologists have this idea. Let's scan all the world, and then after that, we see what we can do with the result. This has no sense. So that's a major, major information theory question. I'm not expert in it. But it's the same when you observe the internet. The internet is in zettabytes. Journalists say the internet, Google saves the internet, saves everything on the internet. That's bullshit, I mean, by orders of magnitude. So what does Google save from the internet when analyzing behaviors and so on? It's the same question. So compressed sensing. I'm not the... but of course, in imaging, it has been done a lot with waveless, with compression. But for many other areas, it's an open problem. Reliability, the bug question is central. The advantage is that now, and reproducibility, the advantage is now the programs have a much longer lifetime. But they need care. That is, software rusts. Okay? And it needs care. But for example, there is at INRIA a new project, and it's not only INRIA, which is called Software Heritage, which is trying to save all the software for reproducibility. There is experience, because on an airplane, when you build an airplane, you need to save everything so that it can fly for 50 years. So you save the computers. The only thing you don't save is electricity. Okay? So you do that. So that is very important. It's already managed in quite many industries because, for example, I worked on the retrofit of the Ariane computer, by new ones. It took 2 years just to check it would work. You see, so people are really working on that. It's expensive. It is expensive. So gathering data is not the solution. Understanding what to do with data together with the gathering makes sense. It's not simple. Now being able to redo what has been done is getting better. It's getting better. For example, because you can simulate computer by computers. For example, gamers, they play the very original Tetris on real time on a Mac or on a, because they have a disassembled, reconstructed simulators of the machines and so on. It's doable, it's expensive. People think informatics is cheap, that's not true. Sorry? Yeah.
No, we.
Okay. It needs to be, the principle needs to be set from the beginning, otherwise, it's too late. It's very early, too late. But sometimes it's much too. For example, I made a report on nuclear plant safety, and I wrote, the coefficients computed for stopping the power plant were computed by a Fortran program in the 50s, and nobody knows what this program does. That's another way of going too much in the wrong direction.
Thank you for your talk. You called your presentation the informatics revolution in the science, in plural, science. I would, in my view, is the science, with capital science, the science revolution in informatics, which we see today, and we perhaps more. Because I think that from what you presented to us is applied science examples, applied science vision of what is going. Because what we see from these examples, and many others, in all parts of science, is the transfer and the evolution from fundamental science at some time to the applied, every day you apply technology, and is the well-known process of transfer of knowledge. So that is my point. And the point is that if you enlarge and put this in the terms of fundamental science and the transfer, so informatics is appears is the quantum physics.
I cannot quite agree because there are many parts I did not develop. First, informatics by itself is a fundamental science, a lot of fundamental science. Second, it's also important in fundamental sciences. It's not in what I presented, no. You don't present a science and its application in the same talk. But if you go to the web, you have my course at Collège de France, and you will see that, okay? So it's not the same talk, simply. And also informatics is also changing mathematics, for example. For example, you see the Kepler conjecture, we saw Kepler, how to pack oranges in an optimal way. So it was opened in 1611. It has been solved in 2012 by informatics. That is, the mathematics is unsolvable by human being, and the proofs has been checked on computer.
Internet was created by fundamental physics.
There is no relation.
I have a question. You've highlighted the issue with teaching informatics, and we're all scientists, but also teachers here. So how do we improve on that? What can we do to improve on the general knowledge about informatics, and especially for us scientists, the knowledge of our students and the next generation of scientists in informatics? What should we do?
Okay. We do a lot of things already. You should participate. I've been working with the ministry for 10 years, and now it's officially in the programs. Which means that it's in primary school, college, and lycée have to teach informatics. With a little caveat that there is zero money to teach the teachers, train the teachers. Well, okay. Now the problem is that the informatics people like me are the only ones to raise this problem. I think all scientists should raise this problem. No, but publicly, I mean, publicly. And or to the ministry and so on. You know, I ended my first lecture at Collège de France. I gave three inaugural lectures because I got three chairs. And the first one, I ended it by saying, in terms of education, France is entering the 20th century. Okay? But not only France. So it should be a common effort. And there have been something absolutely marvelous. You know, La main à la pâte.
Oui.
By Pierre Léna. Hein? La main à la pâte was geared towards natural sciences, period. And I convinced Pierre that he should do the same for informatics. And you have two books out now called 1, 2, 3, Codé, for training of teachers of primary and college. They are fabulous. And they are not teaching informatics at the old time, because they are using Scratch, for example, or little robots. Because this is, I was a Montessori teacher, so I know about that. This is informatics for the kids, in the universe of the kids. And they learn full speed. They always learn full speed what is in the universe. So I think that all sciences should join. But I made a report, I coordinated a report on the Academy of Sciences, and the other science did not come. We invited people, they did not come. And the other science fought not the report to be published. And then they thought it would have no impact. It had a huge impact. So the first thing that other science should do is to recognize the existence of informatics as a science. That's it. I was in Polytechnic in 85, I will remember, and now I'm president of the Committee of Teaching and Research. I went there to this committee in 85, and the subject of the day was, should we start teaching informatics at École Polytechnique? And I started this way, and thanks to have invited me, the last time I was in this committee was in 1968. The subject was, should we start to teach informatics at École Polytechnique? And I'm happy to see that the same subject in the same state. But if you want, I take you to MIT and Stanford. So they started. But we got really obstacle from the other sciences. Physicists say this is bullshit, mathematics, this is bullshit. This is where the problems are. It's improving a lot.
Can I have your viewpoint on two
there
questions?
There is still lots of way to go. Because, you know, the question that was asked to me is that, is it a science? If it is a science, we teach it. If it's not a science, we don't teach it. I mean, this is a really stupid question.
You suggested two avenues in your talk. One is in your triangle, you talked a lot about matter and energy, and you didn't mention so much the interaction with waves. So could you say a bit more? And the second is you mentioned that some of the problems of how we think of the early universe may be best addressed with cellular automata. Can you say a bit more on these two topics?
Yeah, okay, so the links, of course, the links between the links here are very interesting. It's hard to talk about that in a one-hour talk. The links between matter and energy have occupied physics for quite a long time. And when waves came in Fourier, they came because of waves, sea waves. And then when electromagnetic waves came, the link between energy, matter, and when laser came, so of course, they are all about that. So many people are talking about these links. Okay. Now here, there are two kinds of links. There are bilateral links. That is, matter information. Of course, information needs a support. Information doesn't exist without a support. So there is this link. But this link is minor, because it's a link which is quite known. How can information talk about matter? That is, there is a problem with mathematics. There is a huge gain and a problem. Is that mathematics has the opinion that every formula should be small. Why that? Because we think of our brain only, and we are not able to calculate a non-small formula. But if you take informatics, that's not true. in the orange packing problem, in the Kepler conjecture, he did it in Mathematica with formulae that are infinitely long. I mean, Alain Cohn tells me, Alain Cohn, who is a serious mathematician for physics, he tells me, for me, the tool is Mathematica. I can do nothing without Mathematica. So the barrier of our brain has been pushed somewhere else. So that's a big change. Huh? It's not a detail. Huh? And so when Hales proved his Kepler conjecture, he did huge inequalities in the Mathematica. It's a whole set of, I mean, crazy polynomials and so on. And when the proof, he said, I have a 99% proof when he finished that. But the mathematician objected, Mathematica is informatics. Nothing tells us it is right. Same is true for mathematicians already. They are biology, so. And then he spent 12 years automating the proof. We know how to make large automatic proofs of mathematics. And I know it because the first one who did that was for the four-color theorem, Georges Gontier, who was one of my PhD students. And then he proved the Fayette-Thompson theorem, which is a monster theorem in the 20th century in classification of groups. This theorem starts, the proof in condensed version is 250 pages, and it starts by, to read the proof, for a trained mathematician, it takes 1 year. It's a warning. Now it's all in machine. Heat return, wait 2 hours, proof done. Ah, that's a conceptual thing. That means we are able to do some parts of mathematics in a completely different way. So, for example, for the early universe, is that true that we need to stick to very small laws? Ah, it's not clear. It's not clear. And the problem of the continuum, when it shrinks too much, the equation makes no sense, and linking quantum mechanics. And is it the only way of thinking, to think as before and to shrink the thing? No. It's not the only way. There are other ways. It's not telling that we succeed. But nobody knows if anything we succeed. So I think that it brings new ideas, not necessarily new solutions. But bringing new ideas has always been absolutely necessary to solve hard problems. So it's one new ID provider.
People are still here, so let's continue questions. It's fascinating.
Thank you for the talk. I have a question that might be a bit general, but we as physicists have problem when using informatics because most of our equations are continuous while informatics is discrete. And my question is, does informatics have to be discrete? Yes, have to be discrete, or could we think of continuous informatics?
Okay, that's a major question. It dates back to Shannon. The problem with continuous devices in physics, that is calculating devices, is noise. So what informatics does is control noise. What digital informatics does, why analog circuits have disappeared? Because they cannot control noise. And with digital, you can go to arbitrary precision. So there are lots of things there. For example, there was a course at Collège de France by Jean-Daniel Boissonnat on computational geometry, which is something absolutely relevant for astronomy, by the way. And the question is, you have a notion of precision in mathematics, okay? When you do formal series or whatever, you have a notion of precision, which is mathematical. And then you have the floating point numbers, which have another notion of precision, which has nothing to do with physics. And it's well known that there is a big problem. So there is much more control now of that. Also, you have probabilistic algorithms with a very good control on the numerical precision you need to have good analog precision. So there is a lot of work there. Now, can we build machine with other technologies? The answer is yes. And Moore's law, the abandon of Moore's law by industry, remember, Moore's law is not a law in the sense of physics. It's a decision of the industry to follow this law. Okay? So the abandon opens the door to something which was impossible before, is to do research on different hardware. And neuromorphic machines, the machines that try to work a little bit like neurons, like deep learners or things like that, noise is extremely important for them to work. So it's completely the contrary of before. The brain is extremely noisy, and noise plays a fundamental role in the way the brain works. It's a positive role, it's not a negative role. So there is opening to have completely different machine structures for some problems. Not for landing Schiaparelli on Mars, but for modeling, it can be. We are very good, okay, with no watts, 20 watts there, and an awful lot of noise. That makes us jealous. Huh? You mean if you want to do deep learning for one problem, you need monster GPUs, and a kid has a mini thing and learns all problems at the same time. Huh? So artificial intelligence is not yet there. So there is room for that, yeah, a lot.
There are many angles to the issues that you have raised. I would like you to comment on the relevance for you of the idea of open source coding and free software.
There are two kinds. Yeah, open source coding and open source data is something very important. Both, and they are similar. Open data is a big problem, probably not in astronomy, I don't know. In biology, for example, you look at Institut Pasteur, Institut Curie, all research centers, they say, we want to have access to all the data of the world, but we want to make money out of our data. That will not be easy, okay, both sides. Open software, that's very good. There are lots of open software libraries of very high quality. You cannot do everything in open. When I made my company, I decided not to be paid magically anymore. I was a civil servant, I became an industrial. So my salary came from where? From software, because this is the only thing we sold. So I have friends who did, I will make a company out of open software. You have to think not twice, but hundreds of times. There are cases that work, very numerous, and the work they do in this company is absolutely boring. So scientific software open, absolutely. General usage, tech is fantastic, okay? It's open. I see tech done by Microsoft, you see, that would have been very, very bad. And we have to find the right balance. Data, yes, but it is very costly. Putting big data in the cloud is very costly. And I don't think because it needs to be saved, it needs to be broadcast, you need big servers. If the data is not used, no problem, but if it is used, and you use data, so it's expensive. So it has to be a major investment. In astronomy, where the budgets are already astronomical, it makes no difference whatsoever. But in other places, for mathematicians, for example, it's a big problem. I'm very much in favor of open data. And I'm also very much in favor of industrial programs because, for example, Linux, I was an advocate of Linux. We got the very first Unix in my lab. And now I say Linux was never interested in the only problem that matters in a computer, which is the man-machine interaction. And it cannot succeed because the people who do Linux, they say this is a negligible problem. Well, I say, okay, so I will go to Windows and Apple. So, you know, you need to be non-pretentious in the field. But open data is fundamental in science, especially in non-easily reproducible science. I think this is what you do. Ligo Virgo is open. Or sufficiently open? I think you are not that bad in astronomy. Huh? But in biology, there is in astronomy, you have little production industry. You don't build planets so far. You don't build. In biology, they have the pharma industry.
Let's conclude here and thank Gérard again.
Thank you.